Good evening everybody, welcome to the programming guide channel. This is Bhargavi. Today we are going to discuss about the process states in the operating system. So first we need to understand what is mean by a process. So process is nothing but a set of instructions. So that instruction to be executed by the operating system, that we call it as a process. So one more thing also we can write, process is nothing but a program or a thread. So anything we can write as what? Thread. So program is also nothing but what? Set of instructions to be executed to perform a specified task, that is a program. We can also call that as a process. Now when a process is entering into the system, that means into the operating system, it may changes the states. So what are the states we have in process state diagram? So first we need to go through the new state. Consider there are three processes. I'm considering P1, P2 and P3, right? So I'm doing three tasks in my computer. The first one is I'm doing Word, I'm opening Excel, and I'm writing one more C program in one editor. So these are the three different processes to be executed by the operating system. And what are the states are in the process state diagram for this process we will see. Now each and every process must and should go through all these states compulsory, right? Now first every process, whichever process we started, that will enter into the new state. That means we started processing. So now already P1, P2 and P3 are in new state, right? Now P1, P2, P3 are started at the same time. But the CPU will execute, or that means operating system will execute only one process at the same time. Why? Because we are considering single system. Now, from processes P1, P2, P3, from new state to, they will go for ready state. So, ready state is a queue. So, we can also call it as ready queue. So, queue is nothing but what? What is the queue principle? First in, first out. So whichever the process is coming to the queue first, that will be go out first. So first it is having a queue. So in this queue, first P1 is there, next P2 is there, next P3 is there. Now here processes are moving from new state to ready state. Yes. Now who is taking these processes from new state to ready state? We have long term scheduler, LTS. So long term scheduler is a scheduler which takes the processes from new state and places in the ready queue. So that is the task of the long term scheduler. Now all the processes whatever we have considered, those processes are in the ready queue. Now this ready queue will send one by one process to the next state, that is running state. That means that will be given to the RAM. So in running state, what we have, RAM will be there. So in RAM, we'll allocate the memory for the respective process and operation will be done by the operating system. Now from ready state to running state, who will send the processes? That is done by the short term scheduler. Short term scheduler is a scheduler which takes the processes from ready queue state to running state. Now here, based on the algorithm, so this short term scheduler have different kinds of algorithms. So which algorithm? For example, we have algorithm as FCFS, first come first serve principle, shortest job first, and priority scheduling algorithm, and then round robin scheduling algorithm. So according to the scheduling algorithm, whichever scheduling algorithm we choose, that will take the, according to these scheduling algorithms, the shortest term scheduling algorithm takes the process from the ready queue to running state. That means based on the chosen algorithm, short term scheduler takes one of the process from the ready queue and sends it to running state. Clear? Now this running state, consider the shortest short term scheduler is taking the process P2. Consider. Now in running state, what, which process is there? P2 is there. Now P2 is executing by the operating system. Now if the P2 is completed its task, now then it will move to the exit state. Exit state we can also call it as deallocation. So whatever the memory we allocated for the process P2, that is deallocated after completion of the process. Consider in this case, if the process is not completing its task, now it want to execute some of the input output operations. It want to execute some of the input output interrupts, all we can call as some of the input output interrupts, or we can call as input output operation. So that means what, this process P2 want an input device or want an output device. At that time, what the operating system will do? The operating system will send this process, whichever the running process is there in the running state, that will be sent to the blocked state. That means currently whatever the process we are executing, operating system will tell the process to go to the blocked state and do your task, that means getting of input and outputs, and stay there only. Again we'll send back to the process P2 to the ready queue. That means what, the process P2 want input. So at that time what the operating system will do, it will give the permission to go out from the running state to blocked state and take the input output and again come back. Clear? Now P2 is in blocked state. Now it has taken some input. So P2 is doing what Excel it is doing. So from student table we are writing. So 1, 2, 3. So these are the 3 inputs. So we need it from the keyboard. So the input will be taken by the process P2. Now from the blocked state, as soon as it's completed its works, it sends this blocked state process to the ready queue. That means from the initially P1 is there, P3 is there. P2 will be moved off. Now what will do? P2 will be here, right? Now P2 again moves from blocked state to ready queue state. Now for consider, P2 is in the blocked state. Now at that time CPU will sit idle. Is the CPU will sit idle? No, it will take one of the process of P1 and P3 to the running state, so that we can utilize the CPU efficiently. We can utilize the CPU very efficiently. When one process is going to be in blocked state, some other process to be getting from ready queue to running state. Consider the P1 is executing according to these algorithms. So P1 is in running state, P2 is in blocked state, P3 again ready queue state. As soon as P2 completed its input task, it will again go to back where? To the ready queue only. Clear? Again it is in the queue, first in first out principle. Again if P2 want to execute it, so if the operating system want to execute P2, it selects any one of the algorithm and takes the P2 from ready queue to running state. Who does this job? Short term scheduler will perform the task. Clear? For example, one more thing we have. Consider here process P1 is executing, process P3 and P2 are in ready queue. Now P2 has a higher priority. P2 has higher priority than the P1. So immediately operating system will stop the process of P1 and it says that go back to the ready queue. That means P1 will again move to the ready queue. So who is coming to the running state? P2 is coming to the running state. Why? Because it is having high priority. So this job also done by the short term scheduler. So when we use this one, if you are applying priority scheduling algorithm, whichever the process has highest priority, that process to be executed first. So if the process comes with the highest priority, the lowest priority process should go again back to the previous state, that means to the ready state, so that as soon as the process P2 is completed, P1 or P3 will be executed. Again it applies the priority. So which one has highest priority? P1 or P3? So P1 or P3? P3 is coming here. Now the process P1 and P3 are here. So whichever the process is highest priority, then the next process will be sent to the running state by the short term scheduler. Clear? For example, if you are taking round robin scheduling algorithm, so it is has a time quantum. So every process should have a time quantum. Consider P1, P3 are here. Now P2 is running over here. So round robin scheduling algorithm uses the time. So it uses the time quantum for 1 nanosecond. Consider. So what will happen if 1 nanosecond of the P2 process is completed, it will preempt the process again back to the ready queue, and whichever the process is there in the first, so that will be executed. Now P2 will move out and P3 will come into the running state. That means every 1 nanosecond only one process is going to be executed. First P1 is completed, next P2 is completed, now running with the P3. As soon as P3 is completed, P2 will be here, again P3 will come here and P1 will come here. That means the rotation process will be done for every 1 nanosecond. The swap in swap out processes should be done. So this is also done by the short term scheduler algorithms. Clear? So long term scheduler makes the process from new state to ready queue, and short term scheduler makes the processes from ready queue to running state. Now, if any interrupt is occurred for the input-output operations, the process particularly moves from the blocked state, again blocked state, it will move to the ready state. So here, two things we need to understand. First one is preemptive and non-preemptive. Preemptive and non-preemptive. So, preemptive is nothing but preemptive, that means before completing of a process, a process is terminated, that means a process is stopped suddenly, that we call it as preemptive. Before completion of the particular process, we are stopping the execution of the current process. Why? Because the highest priority process is waiting in the ready queue. Consider here, we have three processes. So the process P2 has the first priority, process P1 has the second priority, process P3 has the third priority. Consider first, initially P1, P2, P3 are here, P1 is in this state. Now what is happening? P1 is currently executing in the running state, P2 and P3 are here. Now the P2 has the first priority. So what will do? Operating system will stop the process of P1. Why? Because P2 has the highest priority. So the execution of execution of the process P1, we currently stop and will send this back to the ready queue. Why? Because P2 has the highest priority compared to P1. That means preempting, process is not completed still, but we are terminating here and we are sending it back to the previous state, that is to the ready queue. That we call it as a preemptive. Before completion of a process, stop the execution of the process. Now, non-preemptive is nothing but even though highest priority process is coming in the ready queue, P1 should not stop its execution. So until unless P1 completed, P2 can enter from ready queue to running state. That we call it as a non-preemptive. So preemptive scheduling algorithms we have, non-preemptive scheduling algorithms we have. If you are applying non-preemptive scheduling algorithms, means what? If a process is in running state, until unless it completes that work, no other process can enter into the running state. But in preemptive, if a highest priority process comes into the ready queue, as soon as that, the process which is running in the running state, that will stop and send it back to the ready queue state. So this we call it as a preemptive and non-preemptive. And we have two schedulers, long-term scheduler and short-term scheduler. Next comes for the terms of medium-term scheduler. So medium-term scheduler again performs the other task, that is, consider here the blocked is also a queue. So as soon as we have ready queue, similarly the blocked state also have a queue. So consider in a queue we have only 3 processes. So the space of the RAM is very less, so it can store only 3 processes, P1, P2 and P3. If some other process is coming to the blocked state, what will happen? The queue is already full. So we have one more state, that is blocked suspended. So blocked suspended is nothing but what? If the queue size is full in the blocked state, one of the process from the blocked state will move to the blocked suspended state. So that we'll have some space here, so that one of the process P1, P2, P3, consider P1 is coming here, so that we can store the P4 here. So that means if the space of the blocked state is queue is full, we consider blocked suspended, like a virtual memory. We imagine some other memory is there, there we are storing the processes. So here this task will be done by medium term scheduler. Clear? So here we call it as a medium term scheduler. Similarly, here ready queue is also one of the queue. So here also if the ready queue size is also full, why? Because it is also a RAM. So we are storing the values, that is nothing but a RAM. Now if this queue is also full, we have ready suspended. So we have one more state, that is ready suspended. If the ready queue size is full, we'll temporarily store the processes which are coming from new state to ready queue in the ready suspended state. Considering here we have P3, so P3 are coming to the ready queue. So P1, P2, P3 are there. Now a new process is P4, now it is coming into the ready queue. So what will happen? The queue is already full with the P1, P2, P3. Now one of the process from this ready queue will send it to the ready suspended, and this P4 will occupy the space here. Consider P4 will come here, P1 will be moved to there. That means if the space is full, then only we will take one more state, that is ready suspended, and here for the blocked suspended. So these two terms, these two states will be handled by medium term schedulers. So this is about the process state diagram. So I'm completely revising once again. First, all the processes will be in the new state. Then with the help of the long term scheduler, it will move to the ready queue state. Then from ready queue state, with the help of the short term schedulers, it moves to the running state. If any process want any input output interrupts, then it will move to the blocked state, and from blocked state it will move to the ready queue. If the process is want to execute, that means if the process is completed, then it moves to the exit state. From the blocked state, if the blocked state is full, it will virtually create a one more queue, that is blocked suspended state, that will be done by the medium term scheduler. Similarly, if the ready queue of the ready queue state is full with the queue, that means if the queue is full here, if one more state is created, ready suspended, that means we imagine that one, so that one of the process from the ready queue will be send it to the ready suspended state. So this also handled by medium term scheduler. So this is regarding process state. In this we learned about the definition of the process state and types of schedulers. Thank you for watching my videos. If you like my videos, please subscribe and share to your friends. Thank you.